everybody. Welcome to the first session of Astro and Talk 2023. So we have three speakers today. The first speaker for today's session is Swarnim. And he will be talking about touching the creation of state of the next star using multidisciplinary. So Swarnim, you have 15 minutes and then you have 5 minutes of minutes.
Hello everyone. Thanks for coming to the talk today. Hope you're having a good day. My name is Swarnim Shirke, and I'll be talking about this paper that was put on ATE and also has been accepted for publication in the Astrophysical Journal. The title of it is Constraining the EOS, which is the equation of state of hybrid stars using recent information from multidisciplinary physics. So quick recap, neutron stars are cool, dense, compact objects with mass of about 1 to 2 solar mass and radius of roughly about 12 kilometers. Hybrid stars are basically neutron stars which have deconfined quark matter at the core of them. So this is neutron star structure, and the thing is we don't know what is at the center of it, which is called the inner core. So this is the first motivation. The composition of neutron star core is unknown. So if you see the UCAA phase diagram, the temperature and density, neutron stars lie at very high densities and cold temperatures, and there are no terrestrial experiments which probe this area. So this makes the study of neutron stars even more interesting. Also, there has been it has been conjectured that there is a hadron to quark phase transition which can occur inside neutron star. There are a couple of papers which show new evidence, theoretical evidence for this to happen, like this plot here, where they show a kink in the equation of state which is representative of a phase transition. So this has renewed interest in the community for studying the hadron to quark phase transition. Also, there are multidisciplinary constraints available which we can use from nuclear theory, nuclear experiments, astrophysical observations, and also theories like quantum chromodynamics. The literature that studies this uses either parametric equation of state, basically they take some parameter like polytropes and very polytropic indices to construct equation of state, but that doesn't give any insight into the physics which is going inside that matter. And others use realistic, which has physical background, phenomenological equation of state, but they use select equations of state. So as I'll show, we vary a lot of parameters using phenomenological equations and generate a large set of equations. The part of this work is in continuation with two previous works which was done. So they study correlation between different nuclear empirical parameters, and also another where hyperon degrees of freedom were added and the same study was repeated. Here we have quark degrees of freedom. So for the hadronic matter, we use to describe the hadronic equation, we use the relativistic nuclear model, which is the model having nucleons and protons which interact via exchange of mesons, and the control parameters are some of the nuclear parameters which are which can be measured in lab. From these parameters, we can fit these couplings within the Lagrangian and get the equation of state. So these are the parameters basically which are in our hands. For the quark matter phase, there is an MIT-backed model which was introduced in 1984, which is a simplistic version phenomenological model for deconfined quarks, which has this back parameter B, which takes care of all the non-linearities in the QCD theory. And we also add interaction between the quarks up to first order in this strong constant alpha, which is redefined in terms of A4. So for the quark case, we have these two control parameters B and A4, in total 8. And to mark the phase transition from hadronic phase to quark phase, as we go into the interior views Gibbs construction, which says that we have two conserved quantities, the baryon number and the electric charge, which allows for a mixed phase where the transition begins at this interface and ends here, and as we go inside, as we go at higher densities, we get higher quark content. So these are the parameters that I showed. These are the nuclear ones and these two are the quark ones. We vary them in their known uncertainty range and generate large set of equations of state. Basically, each set of parameters gives us one equation of state, and we generate about 100,000 of such equations. And I've shown two of them here. This, once we fix this, we get the confined phase, which is the hadronic matter. Then we switch to the mixed phase, which has quark matter as well as atomic matter. And finally, we get deconfined quark matter. This is just to represent. And then we use constraints and form of filter functions. At low densities, we have calculations from parallel effective field theory. So we use them. At higher densities, we use two of the astrophysical observations of maximum mass should be greater than about 2 solar mass, and this standard deformity of 1.4 solar mass. And also we add at very high densities calculations from perturbative QCD. So this is roughly at densities greater than 40 times nuclear saturation density, which doesn't occur in neutron stars, but they, as you see, we will get some constraints from it. So these are so the equations will be focused on the left. We have pressure versus chemical potential. So basically we vary all these nuclear this control parameters, and for each parameter we get equation of it. And we generate about 100,000 of such for different parameters. So we get different equations, right? And correspondingly we get a band of equations. For that, for the, all each equation set, we check whether it satisfies parallel effective field theory and some other physical conditions like causality and thermodynamic consistency. And that is marked by this blue band. That's the band we satisfy. Over and above this, when we say that, okay, we have this equation of state, and we also add some astrophysical constraints on it, the number of parameters satisfying that decreases, and we get a subset of that band. We add astrophysical constraints, then we see it should go above 2 solar mass, then that gives the yellow band. And we again add the PPCD, which gives the green band. And this is the corresponding plot in plot for lambda versus lambda. We check some physical quantities which are written here after applying each filter. So I have marked the final one where we apply all these filters. We see what is the result, and it turns out to be about 1.23 per Fermi cube. Nuclear saturation density of the nucleus is around 0.15. So this goes about 8 times of that. And the corresponding chemical potential goes up to 1.96 giga electron volts. Similarly, the maximum mass that we find that satisfies all these constraints goes to 2.52 solar mass. The radius of 1.4 solar mass range comes out to be around 11.4 to 13.1 kilometers. And we find that the tidal deformity of 1.4 solar mass stays above 247. We also check that this posterior is consistent with the mass radius contours from GW1717 observations and NICER observations. These are the explore the correlation between among these different control parameters, like the empirical parameters and nuclear observables. Sorry for so many numbers, but I have marked some things that we will be focusing on. So we see that these parameters, ECM and LCM, are correlated and increases as we add the astrophysical constraints. Next, we also find that this M star is well correlated with all the nuclear this neutron star observables, like maximum mass, radius of 2 solar mass. So it's an important parameter that we see. This is consistent with the previous work, but the new thing here is these parameters B and A4, which comes from the Quark equation of state. As we see, first B is well correlated with the maximum mass of neutron stars, and after adding astrophysical, all become the moderately correlated somewhat. Another new thing we have is the PPCD constraint. So when we add the perturbative PCD constraints, most of the one observation is most of the nuclear observations more or less remain unchanged. We see B is moderately correlated with the maximum mass and the corresponding radius for that configuration. We also see that the correlation between B and A4 emerges. So these two parameters within the Quark matrix itself, they turn out to be correlated. And A4 doesn't seem to be correlated with any of the other observations. These are some observations we take here. These are the corner plot, the posterior distribution for some of the select variables. But I'll just focus on the Quark ones. The rest are consistent with what we already know. So one of the observations we see that if we see this A4 posterior distribution, it becomes peaked after the green is again after adding the PPCD, like all the time. It becomes peaked. So we have this blue, which is more or less uniform, like your prior. Then we add the astrophysical, and after we add PPCD, it becomes constant. So this is one of the observations that we have. And we also see that BA4 space, if we see, it becomes well restricted when we had all the three constraints. So this leading patch. So okay. So to focus on to focus on that BA4 parenthesis, which is the Quark model that we are studying. So we have this BA4 plane. The white, so it's a scatter plot. So white part, so for each point here, if we get a set of BA4 values, which corresponds to one of the equation of state from which we can solve theory and get observed. For this white band, the thing is, when we have the equation of state, we don't get stable hybrid star solutions. So in such cases, what happens is that the phase transition sets in so early that it begins at the surface itself, and we don't have a hybrid set, it's more like a Quark star concept. So for next, for these blue points, we generate the equation of state, we check, okay, it satisfies CFT, so that is the blue region. So all these blue region basically is consistent with CFT. Then we solve the TOV equations, check whether it is consistent with observables. So this patch is not, the only the orange patch that we see, they are consistent. And again, we add the, like I've done before, PKCD constraint. And this is the only region which gives an equation. This is the only region which is consistent with all the three constraints. So this basically is the how it gets restricted. On the right hand side, we have the same plane, but we are plotting different thing. We are seeing what is actually happening inside the neutron star. So region 1 is the same. We don't analyze it. It's not a hybrid star solution. So if I take somewhere B and A4 values in this yellow region, the situation is such that the density at the center of neutron star is not enough to set in the phase transition at all. So we don't get hybrid stars in the first place. We have normal neutron stars for such values. In the green region, we have central density such that the phase transition begins. So we have at some radius inside the neutron star, we get a phase transition. Go from pure hadronic phase to mixed phase. The center density is not high enough to reach the pure quark phase. So basically, we have mixed phase at the center of neutron star. And only for this small blue region, we have enough densities at the center of neutron star that a pure quark phase, so the mixed phase end and a pure quark phase begins. So at the core of neutron star for these parameters, we have pure quark phase. And if we compare these two and we say, okay, all these constraints have to be satisfied. If we compare this, so we see that this blue region is not compatible with this green constraint region. So from here this thought basically hints to us that the core of neutron stars probably have mixed phase and they probably don't have pure quark phase. So this green region only lies mostly in the region 3. So it is one of the conclusions that we don't find a pure quark phase at the center, but a mixed phase where both quark matter and hadronic matter are present. In a mixed fashion. So I will summarize. I just have 1 minute. So basically, we have used a realistic phenomenological model, which comes from microphysics, so we can comment on the physics of it. We have used RMF for hadronic phase, the MIT-like model for quark phase, and Gibbs phase transition to model the phase transition. And we vary all the parameters, which people usually don't do. We have used multidisciplinary physics constraint coming from nuclear parallel effective field theory. Some multi-messenger astrophysical observations and perturbative PCD at very high density. We restrict the parameter space and also study the correlations. Some quantitative result is that the maximum density we find through such exercise is about 1.23 per Fermi cube. Greater chemical potential of 1.96 giga electron volts. The maximum mass we find is about 2.5 solar mass. The radius of the solar mass seems to be around 11.5 to 13 kilometers, and that is the probability about 247. And similarly, we get some limits on its parameters B and A4. We see that PKCD as well as astro constraints significantly restrict this B and A4 control parameter space we have, and we also see an emergent correlation between these two quark model MIT bag model parameters. We also see the peaking of A4 distribution, which was purely an effect of PKCD. And we also find that these observations disfavor the existence of pure quark phase at the center of neutron stars, and probably mixed phase is more preferred. So, that's it. Thank you.